And joining us now on The Debate in Whistler, British Columbia via Skype, Robin Allen, economist and blogger at robinallen.com. In Calgary, Alberta, Roger Gibbons, president and CEO of the Canada West Foundation. In the nation's capital, Martin Lavoie, director of Manufacturing Competitiveness and Innovation Policy with the Canadian Manufacturers and Exporters. And here in studio, Avery Shenfeld, chief economist with CIBC World Markets, and Aaron Weir, economist with the United Steelworkers Union. It's good to have you two guys back here at the table here. And to our friends in Points Beyond, thanks everybody for joining us. I'm going to beg everybody's indulgence for a second here, because Avery, I want you and me to do a little currency fluctuations 101 off the top here. Some of us remember when the Canadian dollar was trading at 65 cents US, and now today it's basically worth the same as the American dollar. Huge fluctuations. What causes currencies to fluctuate?
Well, in the case of the Canadian dollar, there's been several factors, all of which went one way. We did have a rise in resource prices. Beyond just oil, you know, metals, other things, even grains that Canada exports, are trading at higher world prices. So foreign buyers have to buy more Canadian dollars for each barrel of oil, each ton of copper that they purchase from us. That's certainly been part of it. The US dollar generally weakened against other currencies, so a rising tide, in effect, lifted other boats, including the Canadian dollar. And lately, actually, there's been a third factor, which is sort of our AAA seal of approval. Our bonds are now a rare breed that they have a AAA rating. And what we're seeing is that foreign investors, and that includes central banks and includes some bond funds, have decided to buy more Canadian government bonds, provincial bonds. And again, they have to buy Canadian dollars to do that. So all of this buying has, in effect, pushed up our currency.
Now, what's behind the appreciation of the Canadian dollar, let's say, just over the past decade in particular?
Well, really, the past decade, it's been those three factors. If you go back, when our currency was weak, we weren't as solid a credit at that point. We were improving, but other credits were also AAA. Resource prices were a lot lower, so we were not getting that bounty of buying on our raw materials. And the U.S. dollar was actually head and shoulders above everybody else. At that point, everybody wanted U.S. dollars. In fact, in some sense, in that point in time, the U.S. was wrestling with what we're wrestling with today, which is their currency was overvalued and they had the rust belt. They had trouble in their manufacturing sector as a result.
Let's do one more here. We often hear Saudi Arabia described as having a petrodollar, Iraq having a petrodollar. We're hearing the Canadian dollar described as a petrodollar. Is it?
Well, things aren't always black and white. This is sort of gray in the sense that, yes, oil is part of our trade balance, increasingly important. So when oil prices go up, that does have a correlation with the Canadian dollar. If you put the two on a chart in the last 2 years, you really couldn't deny that fluctuations in oil prices affect the Canadian dollar. But it isn't the whole story. Last year, in fact, we were running a trade deficit at various points with the rest of the world, and the Canadian dollar was still strong. And at that point, I'd actually blame more the buying of our government bonds for safety and security than the oil patch. But oil is clearly a contributing factor.
Okay. One of the reasons we're going to have this discussion tonight is because of 12 seconds worth of something that Dalton McGuinty had to say not too very long ago. He said it about the province of Alberta, and his counterpart was not pleased. Michael, if you would, roll the tape, please.
If I had my preferences as to whether we have a rapidly growing oil and gas sector in the West or a lower dollar benefiting Ontario, I'd tell you where I'd stand with a lower dollar.
Okay, Roger Gibbons, help us understand why that comment went over like a lead balloon in Western Canada.
Well, I think there's a recognition that the strong dollar does hurt the manufacturing sector in Canada. The question is, so what? Implicit in the Premier's comment was the suggestion that we could restore a low Canadian dollar by somehow suppressing economic growth and economic activity in Western Canada. That doesn't go over very well, and it doesn't make any kind of economic or national sense.
Martin Lavoie, when the Premier had that to say, what was your reaction to it?
From our perspective, Steve, we see the strong natural resources as a bit of a challenge and an opportunity. It's a challenge, of course, as you said, there's a it make the dollar higher, so make business costs higher for manufacturing. But let's I think there's two false assumptions with this. The first one is that natural resources only benefit one or two provinces. That's false. The natural resources, and Avery said it a little bit earlier, it's nickel, it's iron ore, it's potash in Saskatchewan, so it's northern Quebec, northern Ontario, the Ring of Fire, there's a lot of mining development over there. So I think eventually all provinces would benefit from it. The other thing I would say with regards to the opportunities is that there will be opportunities for some manufacturing subsectors to grow, and they are already growing. If you look at the whole manufacturing sector, if you compare pre-recession level and today, the only sector of manufacturing that is back to the level it was in terms of manufacturing output, it's the whole machinery and transportation equipment sectors, which benefits from a big surge in construction, mining, and oil and gas development across the country. So I would say it's a bit of both. So our reaction was mitigated. It's not, I don't like to describe it as the Ontario versus the petrodollars. It's, as Roger said it, we need to be smart economically thinking about it in the future.
Now, I appreciate your position, but that is kind of the way that the Premier of Ontario framed this thing earlier in the week or several days ago. And so we do want to follow up on that. Last week, I think it was, now that I think of it. Of the 250,000 jobs, Aaron, that this province has shed, a lot of them have been steelworkers. So where do you guys come down on this issue of whether what's happening in Western Canada is good for the whole country or whether a lower dollar would be better for everybody?
Well, I think the Premier did raise a very important point, which is that the development of petroleum resources has really inflated the Canadian dollar, and that has made manufacturing exports less competitive. But I wouldn't frame it so much as a regional issue. I mean, this affects manufacturers in Alberta as well. One of the reasons that all the bitumen being extracted from the tar sands is not being processed in Alberta is that the Canadian dollar is so high, and it's therefore being shipped south of the border. So, I mean, I think there's an important issue here, but I don't think it should always be framed as a conflict between different provinces.
You won't be surprised if media tend to want to play it that way, though. That does
sound
newspapers.
I won't be surprised if the Premier of Alberta wants to play it that way right before her provincial election. So I get the politics of it, but economically, I think there actually are some solutions that would benefit both regions. For example, if we believe that currency is overvalued, the Bank of Canada could actually step in to bring it down to a more moderate level. Our central bank effectively has an unlimited supply of Canadian dollars that it could sell to damp down the exchange rate. And over the past year, we've seen a lot of other countries around the world do exactly that. The central banks of Switzerland, Brazil, Japan have all taken that sort of action.
Okay, Robin Allen, come on in here from Whistler, BC on Skype and tell us where you are on this discussion.
Well, I think it's very important to remember that, you know, we are not an energy superpower. That as long as we import half of our oil from Middle Eastern countries and countries that are having a declining supply like Norway and Mexico, Canada has a real vulnerability to the same markets that the United States and China are worried about. And so we have to look at the whole question from the point of view of how do we get our energy security in Canada first? And if we did that, it actually would have a nice dampening pressure on the Canadian dollar. And I think the second thing that's really important to remember is that all the studies that are coming out from the West talk about this glowing future from resource extraction and kind of shipping it offshore to be refined. But any of the studies you look at, they all assume the Canadian dollar doesn't appreciate. With Enbridge, they're actually assuming an 85 cent Canadian dollar for the next 25 years. Hmm. With the Siri study, which is the one that Premier Redford uses to support all these trickle-down jobs that are supposed to come to Ontario, if you look at that study, they actually say, without the Bank of Canada and the federal government coming to our aid, we're looking at a Canadian dollar that is $2 US by 2044. And they're also saying a $200 barrel of oil. But the way they deal with that problem, because we trade this oil in US dollars, every time our dollar goes up, our companies in Canada don't do as well, our oil companies. And so what they say is, we're going to assume the Canadian dollar stays at par, and we're going to let the price of oil double to $200 a barrel, and that's how we're going to get this growth. So there's a little bit of a secret going on here, and that is the oil companies in Western Canada suffer when the dollar appreciates.
Huh. Okay, Robin, you've shared some numbers with us. I want to share some more numbers, because if you want to know why Dalton McGuinty is so particularly sensitive about the manufacturing issue vis-a-vis the West's riches right now, here's the tale of the tape. If you would, Michael, let's bring these numbers up. Here is manufacturing in Ontario as a percentage of the Ontario economy. If you go back 10 years, manufacturing jobs made up 22% of our economy. Then if you go to 2006, 17%. And now that we've been through the Great Recession, we're down to 13%. What does that mean as expressed in terms of jobs? In 2004, there were more than 1 million jobs in this province thanks to the manufacturing sector, and we've shed almost 250,000 jobs in this province. So says Stats Can, as a result of what we've been through. Avery, tell me this, though. How much of that shedding do you want to attribute directly to the currency fluctuation we talked about right off the top?
I think you have to be careful to count it all, because part of what's going on is we are making the same number of widgets with fewer people. In other words, if you look, the trend in manufacturing employment in the U.S. hasn't been great either. And this is really like a repeat of what we saw, you know, decades and generations ago in agriculture. We can grow the same amount of food with fewer people on the job. And to some extent, that's something you want to see. We don't want to have... We want to be productive with the workers we have. That's how we can pay them a lot, you know, if you get a lot of output per worker. The second piece of the story is, though, when we look at market share or employment share. So we can compare where are we, how are we doing relative to the U.S., apples to apples, and there we are clearly losing ground. And it might be as much as half of the losses we're talking about here associated with that market share loss. The other concern I have is that the story isn't yet over. If we look at what's happened to manufacturing capacity, that is, where are plants being opened and expanded, and where are plants being closed, in Canada, we're still seeing manufacturing capacity falling. In other words, it fell during the recession, and it continues to fall. In the U.S., it took a much smaller dip during the recession, and it's starting to grow. So to me, that's a sign that in the battle for the next plant, or which plant stays open, the Americans are winning at our expense, and therefore, the job losses that we're suffering as a result of those closures are clearly linked in, you know, in part to the high value of the Canadian dollar. The average Canadian industrial worker is now paid about 20% more than the average U.S. industrial worker if you put them both into U.S. dollars. We used to actually be a bargain. When the Canadian dollar was, you know, 65, 70 cents, our workers were a lot cheaper.
Sure. And not to mention that the healthcare was included as well.
And the healthcare costs on an additional savings.
Yeah. Can I get your view on how much of the job loss you want to attribute to the fact that our Canadian dollar is so much more valuable today than it was a decade or more ago?
I would echo the statement as well with regards to, you know, the shrinking part of manufacturing and the total jobs in most of the economies, such as Canada, is the U.S., is a global trend. I don't think I would attribute too much to it to the oil and gas sector or to the mining sector. It's a global trend with other factors have had a consequence on it. So I wouldn't attribute such a big part in terms of employment. Of course, you see the higher productivity level in Canadian manufacturing in Ontario, and that manufacturing is turned into advanced manufacturing with more automation, which makes that our manufacturing sector is becoming more R&D intensive and less labor intensive. If you look at the type of new plants that open in Ontario or in Quebec these days, they're mostly R&D people, design engineers. They're high-skilled jobs, people with have university degrees. It's way different than what you found maybe 10 or 15, even 20 years ago.
Aaron, we've heard this term before, Dutch disease. Tell us what that means.
Well, it's basically the idea that an appreciation of natural resource exports drives up a country's currency to the point where other exports are no longer competitive in outside markets, and imports actually become much more competitive in the domestic market. It's called Dutch disease because this happened to Holland in the 1960s when a lot of oil and gas was discovered in the North Sea. And I guess I would suggest that it's happening to Canada now.
Well, that's what I want to know. Do you think we're suffering from Dutch disease right now?
I mean, I do think so. I think there's absolutely no doubt, you know, as Avery mentioned, that all of this resource development is driving up the exchange rate. And it's not just the inflow of foreign currency to buy the resources themselves. It's also the inflow of foreign currency to buy equity in the resource industries. So foreign investors buying Canadian dollars to take over Canadian oil companies or to buy shares in those companies, all of this drives up the currency. And yeah, there's no question, it's destroyed a lot of manufacturing jobs in this country.
Roger, how about it? Are we suffering from Dutch disease in this country?
I don't think so. I think what we're seeing is a more profound structural change in the nature of the Canadian economy. And we're dealing coast to coast with the problem of volatility. I mean, the fluctuating Canadian dollar is a concern to the oil patch as much as it is, it's a concern of the oil patch as well as the manufacturing sector. But we're also dealing with tremendous volatility in terms of resource prices. So natural gas yesterday hit a 10-year low in Canada. The West has been forced to deal with this volatility as part of the everyday experience. And yet, the region as a whole has done relatively well. So I think we have to look at the problems that the manufacturing sector in Ontario is having, recognize that the problems are real, but don't jump to a quick conclusion that somehow we can fix the Canadian dollar and restore the Canadian economy to some sort of golden age. The world is changing around us. We're going to be buffeted around by that. It can't be helped. And we have to figure out how to handle it nationally. But we can't sort of turn the clock back and say, you know, we'll go back to the golden age of Ontario manufacturing. It's not going to happen.
Avery?
I guess the one issue is also whether you call it a disease. Because to some extent, what the world is telling you is that a barrel of oil today relative to a basket of, you know, telephones or calculators or the types of consumer products that we now import, a barrel of oil is worth a lot more than that basket of manufactured goods. And as a country, it's not a disease if we start to shift activity to producing goods that the market is paying a large price for and not producing the things like T-shirts and so on that we can buy very cheaply in other countries.
Well, it is a disease if you made T-shirts in this country.
So that's right. So there's a difference between the national picture where it may not be a disease. It may be Canada's advantage that we have strength in these resources. But that doesn't mean for each and every region this is a plus. Just as, you know, shifting workers and people out of remote fishing towns in Newfoundland to other occupations when the cod disappeared was a transition and a bad one for the people who used to live off the fish. You know, today many of them have jobs in Alberta's oil sands. You know, people are flying from planes to Newfoundland to work in the oil sands or even in Newfoundland's own oil sector. So it's not a disease in that sense. It's not all a negative story, by far from it. But nevertheless, the people who are negatively affected, the people in the sectors where we're shrinking, obviously are going through tough times. And the people who are living in the parts of Ontario where that's concentrated are obviously going through tough times.
Robin, let me get your view on whether this Dutch thing is a disease or something else.
Well, I think that about half of our problems with the economy right now are related to the Dutch disease or syndrome, or whatever you want to call it. In terms of an appreciation of our dollar due to rapid resource extraction. Now, the thing is that there's also the devaluation of the U.S. dollar internationally, and that's affecting our trade relations with the U.S. But I think the thing to remember here is that when you talk about having a resource extraction policy that takes dominance over a manufacturing or an industrialization policy, you are really talking about deindustrializing Canada and putting your emphasis on commodity prices. They are very volatile and unpredictable, and so it creates vulnerabilities in your economy that didn't used to exist. As well, the skills and abilities required for resource extraction are a lot less than a productive, value-added manufacturing economy. So you are actually dumbing down the economy if you move towards this strategy that ignores the needs of the rest of the society. But a couple of things here. One is we have to look at what's happening with, for example, Keystone XL or Northern Gateway. The oil industry says that we want to access those other markets so that we can raise the price of oil in Canada. The real reason they're doing these pipelines is getting them to markets that have international prices for oil. That means higher oil prices for Canadians. And that means inflation. It means higher operating costs for all businesses. Now, if we were to refocus our energies to diversify our market to Eastern Canada for oil, we could have a number of things happen. One would be that we would actually expand value added and we'd have more jobs. Refining and upgrading is a very high employer. We would also see the price of oil be determined in North America, which would actually benefit consumers. So if consumers' real incomes go up, then domestic demand increases. We would also see that the vulnerabilities of having our oil exported offshore to China when in fact we are being told that there could be supply restrictions in foreign markets. You know, Eastern Canada could be very, very vulnerable and see their refinery margins narrow, and they could be going into layoffs and downsizing. That is not what we want to have happen in the Canadian economy.
Okay, in which case, Roger, let's start a go around on this one. Help us with this. Clearly, we have identified so far in our discussion some significant benefits to having the kind of currency we've got right now. We see what's happening if you're in a commodity-based part of the economy. On the other hand, there have been significant downsides to the high dollar if you're in the manufacturing area. Can you say on balance whether or not the positives outweigh the negatives?
I think you can, because we are adjusting to a global economy that's going through a lot of transition. As was pointed out, we have assets that are increased value in that global economy, and to be able to cash in on that doesn't seem to me to be a bad thing. I would also stress that the shift to more of a resource base should not be seen as dumbing down the Canadian economy. I think that's silly. I live in Calgary. Calgary is not a city where people sort of slouch around with an axe over their shoulder and a bucket in their hands. Resource extraction is a highly technological activity right now, and selling that Canadian expertise is going to be important. So I just reject the idea that the traditional, you know, assembly line is really high tech and resource extraction is sort of the bottom of the pole. It's just not the reality.
Robin, you want to briefly take that back, or are you still sticking with that?
Oh, I'm still sticking with it, because if you take a look at the Chinese national oil companies that are owned by the Communist Party of China that have come into Canada in the last two or three years to buy up companies and own the technological ability, yes, they see the value of the technology and the skills required at the extraction level. But what they also see is that if they can ship it in its raw form to China, they can refine it there where their refineries are subsidized because they're not profitable right now. And then they can upgrade and produce products and sell it to their population that has price control because the price of gasoline is so high. They've actually seen, and it's very clear in their five-year plan, what they want to do is they want to buy up assets in Canada and other countries, get the technology, get the skills, and then take them home to create jobs and upgrade skills and ability in their country. Now, we are not having a strategy that does any of that. And in fact, by not having a strategy, we are going to lose every part of this value-added chain.
Okay, let me run over to Martin for a second here and get his view on that original question, which is, you know, we've seen there's been pluses, we've seen there's been minuses. Regionally, we see who's doing better than others. As a country, on balance, do the pluses outweigh the minuses at the moment, in your view?
Yeah, I think it's obvious that the manufacturing has been, you know, it's been losing with a rapid appreciation of the dollar. But that being said, I agree with the comments made earlier. It's a nonsense economically to try to focus all our public policies to bring the dollar down. What we need to do is to adapt. Having the manufacturing sector adapting to this new situation means investing heavily in productivity and R&D, and that's what they're doing. Maybe not enough that they should, but manufacturers are driving R&D in this country. 50% of all R&D expenses in all industries is made by manufacturing. Of course, we're going to have to, I think, to accept the situation that manufacturing will, in terms of employment, will stay over the midterm along the lines of 10-12% of employment, and that's going to be it. But that means we need to take all the opportunities presented by mining sector in northern mm-hmm. Quebec and Ontario, for example. We estimate, for example, that in the $80 million plan or presented by Premier Charest a couple of years ago, we estimate that about 25% of the jobs created will be in manufacturing. It will be concentrated mostly in machinery for the mining sector and also all kind of goods, products for the construction sector. So yeah, again, going back to the, do we have a disease? If we have a disease, I think the prescription is productivity. But if it was a disease, we wouldn't have these new opportunities presenting for manufacturers to diversify their markets into new sectors of the economy, such as mining extraction.
Aaron, just want to clarify with you. This economy hasn't been good for steel workers, but it's been great for oil workers. On balance, for the country, is it a good thing?
Well, I think we could do more to accentuate the positive. I mean, the province of Alberta could clearly collect much higher royalties from its oil extraction. That would be a good thing for the people of Alberta that own that resource, but it would also reduce these super profits in the oil industry and thereby reduce this inflow of foreign investment that's driving up the currency. And that in turn would be very helpful to workers in other sectors, particularly manufacturing in Ontario. So to me, the question isn't so much whether the positives slightly outweigh the negatives right now. I think there's actually public policies that could help both regions.
How do you like that idea, Avery?
Well, I think you have to be careful on the royalty side. Premier Stelmach tried that with the natural gas sector, and the drilling rigs all went elsewhere. And, you know, this is expensive oil. The oil sands are not the world's cheapest supply of oil. And if the returns aren't there, the investors won't be either. That's not the only game in town. I do think, though, that we can't be entirely laissez-faire, just throw up our hands and say, oh, well, there's nothing we can do. For one, you know, we have to look at what other jurisdictions are doing in the battle for these manufacturing facilities. In the case of the Caterpillar plant that closed here, I understand there were some incentives in Indiana, for example, to produce there rather than here. We did match the auto sector incentives when that was a battle, whose plants were going to close. Both the federal and provincial governments put up some money because the fear was if the Americans were subsidizing, we were subsidizing. And on the currency side, I think as well, we can't be entirely Boy Scouts there either. One of the reasons the Canadian dollar is strong is because we have some foreign central banks that are saying that are manipulating their currencies. And to some extent, they're boosting ours in the process. When these foreign central banks sell US dollar bonds and say, you know, I like Canada a little better now, that does help lower our long-term interest rates. That's a plus, but it is a factor lifting our currency. And the Bank of Canada governor himself has been one of the people saying that we need currencies to be left to adjust, and he's pointing to other countries in particular and saying they're not paying completely fair on the currency front.
Aaron, quick comeback on
that.
Yeah,
if I could just respond briefly to the point about Alberta Premier Stelmach having already tried and failed to raise royalties. And the problem is that those new royalties came into effect right at the start of 2009, you know, at the sort of epicenter of the global financial crisis when commodity prices crashed. I mean, that's what hurt the industry, not the royalty change.
So try it again, you're saying?
Yeah, absolutely, and try it in the context of much higher commodity prices.
Let me get Roger on that. What would the impact of trying to get more royalties out of the companies who are trying to get that stuff out of the ground be, in your view?
Well, there may well be capacity to shift more of that revenue from the private sector into the hands of the Alberta government. That doesn't get us out of this particular box, however. It means that Alberta becomes richer and richer as a jurisdiction in Canada. That can inflame regional tensions as well. So it's, you know, you can shuffle the money around in Alberta, and there may be arguments for doing so, but it doesn't solve the problem of a relatively weak manufacturing base and a strong resource sector across Western Canada.
Okay.
That's the reality we face.
Let me read a little excerpt here from a piece that Daniel Treffler, who's a economics professor at the University of Toronto, wrote in the Globe and Mail. He writes, at this point, you may be thinking that Dutch disease is just code for more whining from Canada's industrial heartland. But there is a deep question lurking beneath the surface of our collective tailing pond. Where do we want to be as an economy in the coming decades? Do we want to be an innovation-based economy? Or do we want to be a resource-based economy? Unfortunately, he writes, we can't be both. The loony won't let us. Canada has regressed. It is time to step back and ask ourselves whether this is what we want. The choice is ours. Sit back while the world commodity demand drowns us in our own tailings, or react aggressively and strategically. Okay, Martin, to you first. Do we have to choose between a resource and a manufacturing economy?
If you want to be in an innovative economy in the future, I would say you need to keep both. We sometimes forget that oil and gas, and as well as mining extraction, is a very R&D intensive industry. Maybe more so in the last decade. But for example, give you just an example, in the mining companies in Quebec have invested more in R&D since 2001 than the pharma industry. That tells you a lot about the kind of R&D they do. Valley is opening up a big underground lab in Ontario right now so they can test all kind of new safety devices for their workers and stuff like that. So I would say, no, don't let go these two sectors. If you let manufacturing go, of course, you're going to turn into a more services-based industry, which we know is less R&D intensive than manufacturing and mineral extraction, for example. So I don't think you have to choose. If you want to be an innovative economy, you need to support both.
Robin, do we have to choose between a resource or a manufacturing economy in this country?
No, I don't think we do if we have a very strong policy that looks at how do we add value at each stage of our production process. And if we do that, we're going to look at ways and means of improving job opportunities, standard of living, and reduce prices for Canadians. So for example, if we were to say, how do we get the oil to Eastern Canada? Because we're not an energy superpower. We have a dependency on foreign markets. We're not making sure that our refineries are having access to lower priced oil so they can produce the products that businesses need to make them more competitive. So I think what we can actually do is if we had a strategy that said first, what does Canada need? Not what does the United States need for its energy security or China need for its, but what does Canada need? Then we would start towards a policy that would support both sectors at the same time.
Let me just go back to Martin for a second, because Martin, we're about to lose our satellite to you, so I want to ask you one more thing here. This is at least two or three times that Robin has said Canada's not an energy superpower. Now, we know for a fact that the Prime Minister of this country wants to make us an energy superpower, be it either with renewables or natural gas or oil sands or nuclear for that matter. Is it fair to say that we're not an energy superpower right now?
I don't know how you define an energy superpower. What I know is that there's for more than $85 billion of projects going on in the next 3 years in oil and gas mining and hydroelectricity sectors. And I'm expecting this number to double over the next 5 years. So if that means that 25% of all of it will come to manufacturing, I'll take it. So if that means that we're an energy superpower, we are. But if we want to grow these projects, don't forget we need to export them. So with oil and gas, for example, if we want to grow the oil and gas sector, we will need to export it. And that means we will need to build these pipelines to get them out of the country.
Understood. Martin Lavoie from Canadian Manufacturers and Exporters, we thank you very much for being on the program tonight. Come join us again, okay?
Thank you.
Merci beaucoup. À la prochaine fois. Okay, how about you on that? Is this country an energy superpower right now?
I think there are some missing pieces. We do need to develop our export capability. Too many of our resources are trapped into either the Canadian market or even just the Canadian and U.S. market. We probably need to be able to export to somebody else. And we're looking, of course, at projects to get our oil, to get our natural gas to Asia, where we might be able to get more money for it. And I think that's a key step. But we also have so many other major projects. I think when we think of energy, we have to remember we've got major hydroelectric plans in Atlantic Canada, Newfoundland, Labrador, Quebec, Manitoba. Throw in all of that, and I think we do meet that definition. And we did a study at CIBC. We looked at the job opportunities associated with all the major projects that are sort of now on the drawing board in a serious way. It's about 1 million person years of employment. Of course, that will be spread out over a decade or two. But the sooner we get on that, the more, in fact, we can deal with some of the job loss that we're seeing in manufacturing and find other jobs to replace it.
You've taken me exactly to where I want to go next. And Roger, let me start with you on this one. A big part of Premier Redford's reply to Premier McGuinty was, sure, there may be a ton of business for us here in Alberta, but there's also going to be $63 billion in economic spin-offs, she believes, and 65,000 jobs in Ontario over the next quarter century. So don't be against us on this. Be with us on this. Does that argument, do you think, hold enough sway to overcome what's happening in manufacturing right now?
No, I don't think it does. I think what we need is is an energy strategy that is more comprehensive, that reaches beyond the oil sands, reaches beyond the petrochemical side of this, and looks at what we can do across a broader energy base. But we have to be practical about this. I mean, there are a lot of arguments being made about how public policy should come to the defense of the manufacturing sector. There are things we can do. There are things we can do in terms of subsidies and protection, but we still face a very competitive global environment. And so there are going to be limits on what we can do. We have to be selective, and we have to build on the strength of the resource-based economy, see that as an asset, because if we're going to find the policy tools, the subsidizations, and so on necessary to shore up the manufacturing sector, we've got to have wealth creation elsewhere in the economy.
To an Ontario economist, and I'm looking at you now, Aaron, does that sound to you like somebody prepared to sacrifice the manufacturing sector?
No, I actually would agree with Roger that what we need is a national energy strategy that's a bit broader than just the oil sands. I mean, I'd like to see a bit more focus on renewable energy, energy efficiency, and there's a lot of sort of green manufacturing jobs in producing the inputs to those types of energy. So I think we have sort of hit on a point of agreement here.
Roger, I didn't want to put words in your mouth there, but my hunch is that there are going to be people in Ontario who will hear what you just said and say, he doesn't care enough about manufacturing. He's selling it manufacturing down the river at the expense of resource-based economy. What's your view?
They might hear that, and they've got it exactly wrong.
You're not saying that.
What I'm saying is you have to build upon strength where you have strength. International markets dictate to a considerable degree where that strength is going to be. So you grow the economy where you can, and then you try to back and fill to protect an older part of the economy. Being realistic, figuring out what we can do in this country and what we can do well.
Okay, Robin, if that's the case, if that's the prescription, who's going to do it?
Well, I think there's a couple things to keep in mind here. The oil and gas sector is subsidized quite extensively right now, and there's been evidence to suggest those subsidies should be removed. So that's maybe the place we should start first, is to stop subsidizing our booming resource sector. The second thing is that, you have to take a look at what's really happening internationally. People say it's a free market, but it's not. You know, you look at China that has a subsidized marketplace, you look at national oil companies that are pushing their own agenda in Canada, and you have to say, well, what happens when this resource boom becomes a resource bust? Because that's what happens with commodity prices. All these studies that are being done pretend this trajectory is going to go up in this positive way over the next 30 years, when in fact that's not going to be the case. So what does Canada do then?
I've got a minute left here, and I want to give it to you, Avery, because let's take Upper Canadian pride out of the equation here. Does it matter to the national economy if Ontario is not, as it has been for 140 years until recently, the engine that drives the Canadian economy?
I think, living in Ontario, I'd like to say I'd want Ontario to be on top, but I think nationally, Ontario has actually been trailing other provinces for the last 8 or 9 years. And I'd expect that actually its growth rate is going to trail, that of the rest of Canada for the next few years as well. Not much we can do about that. But that doesn't mean that for Ontario, they don't want to make the best of it. And I think we do have to remember, we have some assets here. We have a financial sector that's benefiting from the energy sector. Mm-hmm. A lot of the financing comes, and the mining sector. And in fact, the Toronto stock market itself has listings of mining companies that don't even have a mine in Canada, because we're developing that sort of mining finance expertise. We can develop mining engineering expertise as a country. And for Ontario, the challenge really is, what other things can Ontario gear up for, even in manufacturing, to supply the needs of that expanding energy sector?
Gotcha. I want to thank everybody for participating in our discussion tonight. Robin Allen, the past president and CEO of the Insurance Corporation of BC, thanks for being there via Skype on the line from Whistler, BC. Roger Gibbons from the Canada West Foundation in Calgary, Aaron Weir from the United Steelworkers Union, and Avery Shenfeld from CIBC. Thanks so much for being here, everybody.
Thanks for having us.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.